You're listening to Gateway to E-Commerce, a podcast by ClearSale. In this series, global e-commerce leaders discuss challenges, best practices, new tech, and secrets to success. And now your hosts, Raphael. Welcome back to the Gateway to E-Commerce podcast. In this episode, host Raphael Larenko, Executive Vice President at ClearSale, takes a deep dive into the behaviors of new online shoppers that have emerged in 2020, and he talks about how enterprise merchants can accommodate these new consumers. He considers 2021 the year as the year of consolidation. Will these new customers, in the absence of the need of going online, remain buying online? And what's going to be their actual behavior in the presence of other alternatives and options that emerge? After listening to this episode, you'll be able to walk away with tangible steps to keep your emergent customers engaged and loyal to your enterprise brand. But before we get into today's episode, I invite you to read ClearSale's 2021 Consumer Behavior Analysis to unlock powerful insights about global consumer behavior. You can access the report using the link in the show notes or visit us at clear.com. Now, let's dive in.
So 2020 was a year of major changes in the digital space, in the digital e-commerce, digital commerce environment, especially because due to the pandemic effects and lockdowns in multiple cities, a lot of people were exposed to the possibility or actually forced into the possibility of buying online, people that never bought online because they were just comfortable just going to, you know, brick and mortar stores and stuff like that. So what happened in 2020 was that a bunch of new customers were introduced into the online space, and that created a bunch of challenges for the merchants of different and any size during the year of 2020. The interesting thing, though, in regards to the enterprise level merchants, is that very commonly for the new buyers, for people that never bought online, first-time buyers, very commonly they choose brands and companies they already know offline or companies they are used to for a long time. Because again, they are afraid, they're just doing this for the first time because they were quite forced to, and now they're invited to do it. They are forced to do it. So when they go online and they will give a preference, sometimes even regardless of price, small price differences, they will choose those larger organizations and those brands that they are more familiar with, which means that enterprise companies are the ones that experienced a greater uptick into the percentage of people that are buying for the first time in their stores during the year of 2020. So naturally, that brought also a lot of challenges, several new challenges with these new customers and the behavior of these new customers. So the year of 2021 is going to be a year, in my opinion, a year of consolidation of whether or not these new customers, in the absence of the need of going online, will they remain buying online, and what's going to be their actual behavior on the presence of other alternatives and options. So it's clear that some of these e-commerce merchants, especially the larger ones, they conquered some of these customers forever, right? So even with the fewer places in lockdown and the increase in vaccination levels, all the numbers on e-commerce show that we are not back to the numbers, to the levels, and to the volumes we were prior to the pandemic, to the advent of the pandemic. So if you look at the public organizations, that obviously they report their online sales, or at ClearSale's numbers, we also see that the volumes are not back to what they were. So some of those customers, even now that they can go back to the brick and mortar stores, they chose to stay in the e-commerce, right? So we conquered them for life. However, having those customers and having them now experienced a little bit more of e-commerce brings to the enterprise level merchants a couple of challenges. So challenge number one is dealing with the expectations of growth in volume, right? So you had a year of 2020. Your corporate goals were probably more than overachieved, right? Because you expected X in growth, and that you, some of, even some of the largest and the most organized companies in e-commerce, they faced growth rates above 60% if you compare year over year in 2020. So what happened there is basically you speeded up a digital transformation process. And we have to now, the enterprise merchants have to deal with a little bit of the expectations, their corporate level, corporate expectations when it comes to growth in 2021. Can it be as high as 2020? And the answer is very likely it cannot, right? So because you speeded up some processes that usually would take longer, now 2021 versus 2020, the growth rates are not expected to be as high. So while in 2020 a company may have grown 60% versus 2019, now in 2021, I wouldn't expect in this particular example a growth higher than 15%. As I said, because part of this growth, this potential growth that could have happened in 2021, already happened in 2020. The challenge number two has to do with the actual customer and consumer behavior, right? So now that you onboarded as an enterprise, as a consolidated brand, you onboarded the consumer into the e-commerce space. Now the challenge is having him remaining as your customer instead of trying different things. So a customer that was not used to e-commerce now is used to e-commerce is more likely now that is getting comfortable. Now he or she may have the willingness to try different and new brands. So as an enterprise level organization, you gotta try to keep the consumer with you. And while keeping them with you, you will see some changes that usually happen when a consumer is a first-time buyer versus a heavy user of online merchants. And one of them is a lower average order value, right? So the first transaction someone makes online usually is something very higher AOV, higher average order value, because they are just doing the purchase because despite of the fear, they need it, right? So they are just doing this because of, eventually an advantage in pricing or something. So now that they are getting used to, they will buy anything and everything online, right? So they will go with the lower average order value. They will try things that they wouldn't try before. So they were buying electronics and stuff that whose easiness to compare two products is better, is higher. Now you will see consumers trying, clothes, apparel, stuff that may have to be returned and tried in-house. On top of that, I mentioned the returns. That's also a concern because now these consumers weren't familiar with the processes of an e-commerce store, and now they will explore, your customer service, your returns policy, and even eventually your chargeback policy, or your consumers will eventually be presented to the fact they can, ask their money back, that it is an easier process. So that might bring a few interesting challenges to different departments of the organization. Now, as far as fraud and risk, I guess it's important to start by saying that 2020 was the year with the highest rates of highest numbers of phishing websites, highest numbers of data leaks, data breaches. And the consequences for that will happen and will impact throughout the year of 2021. Why? Because when these major data leaks happen, that means that the personal identifiable information is no longer hard to find, right? So you can find, if you're a fraudster, it's no longer a super big issue for you to find, some person's personal information and understanding which is the cell phone number, email address, street addresses, stuff like that. So the first consequence to that is you can't do fraud prevention just by matching, two pieces of information. Let's say, oh, the email matches with the phone number, so let me approve this order. That's I mean, in amid so many, you know, data leaks, data breaches, it makes no sense because, you know, I as a fraudster could just gather these data points together and using somebody else's credit card, delivering to their delivery shipping address, and it's just a fake transaction anyway, right? So simple matchings between these data points are not necessarily enough to prevent fraud. In 2021, you need more sophisticated, more complex processes. On the other side of the same coin, a lot of good clients, good customers, had their data compromised, right? So you and I could just have had our data as part of a data breach and we not even know about it. Those data points were used in fraudulent transactions in 2020. And now in 2021, I, as a victim of this process last year, I may just want to go and buy online myself using my data. The problem is, my phone number and my email address were utilized by a fraudster before. So if my personal information, if those data points are present on a blacklist, for instance, that will decline each and every order that comes with this data. So I come from being a victim, meaning my data was used, I didn't even know about it, and now I just cannot buy online just because the merchants are utilizing this, let's say, old-fashioned concept of blacklists. In my point of view, when it comes to identity theft, nothing should be understood as black or white, meaning nothing is 100% of fraud or 0% chance of fraud. Everything is gray, right? And there are many shades of gray, right? So this personal information, these personal data points used in previous fraudulent transactions should not combine. Obviously, if a data point was utilized in a fraud before, obviously that means a higher risk. Does it mean you should be declining all those orders right away, blocking every order made using some of those data points from happening? Definitely not. Because, as I said, it could be just a victim of a data leak or identity theft now trying to buy something using their own data. I mean, in the example I gave, I was a victim personally of, you know, a data breach, and now I'm using my email because that's my email address, right? And I cannot be, you know, stopped from buying in an enterprise company store, online store, just because I was a victim. So all in all, the pitfalls for 2021 are not that different from usual and normal and regular fraud prevention advice that I would provide any other year. The only thing is there are some nuances, some specific things that 2021 brings that no other year would. But getting back to the basics, obviously it's important to mention again some of the common mistakes people make while prevent fraud, especially when they have internal departments and, you know, enterprise level organizations are not. Free from the risk of making those same mistakes. The standard approach when it comes to fighting fraud is, when in doubt, decline the order. And that's definitely the number one and the major advice I would give, because it's not a good idea. I mean, it's not a good approach. You gotta be focused on the good customers, because not only you would be losing sales, but you would be losing, you know, the future transactions of the same consumer. These consumers are now getting into, you know, the online space, and you need to deal with them in a very positive way. You need to provide them with a very good user experience. Therefore, this, you know, when in doubt, decline policy is definitely not a good idea. Other common mistakes is trying to foresee or to have as a goal to have zero fraud, to face zero fraud. No one will have zero fraud. The only way of having zero fraud is not selling at all. So that's not a good idea. Another mistake, common mistake or pitfall, I guess, is disregard the possibility of being targeted by fraudsters. Meaning, well, I sell this product that is very riskless, so let me not put any fraud prevention policy here because nobody will want to buy this product. Well, we know that everything can be somehow used in a fraud process. If not, you know, reselling the product or the service, at least we've seen fraud even in donations. Why? Because fraudsters can tell, if you have no fraud prevention policy at all, the fraudster will use your website to test credit cards before going into something somewhere else where they want to make, you know, a bigger fraud. So disregarding the possibility of being targeted by fraudsters is definitely a mistake you should not commit. Third is, I guess, choosing a single tool, choosing a single piece of technology and just believing that it's going to be the silver bullet, the solution for all your problems, the one-size-fits-all solution. And there's no silver bullet, there's no one-size-fits-all. It's always a combination, I mean, a decent, effective fraud prevention strategy is always a combination of multiple factors, multiple technologies. So one could come and say, you know, I will implement biometry in my website and now I'm free for fraud. We know how many ways of, you know, deceiving a biometry process are there out there in the market. So please do not assume you will have a single solution that will solve every problem. And in the same line, you shouldn't have a static solution. So that those are my rules, those are my policies, this is my strategy, I'm not changing at all. Fraud is a very dynamic phenomenon, and the fraud prevention shouldn't be static at all. It should be always evolving and adapting to the new trends, as always.
Rafael offered a lot of insight about how enterprise e-commerce merchants can meet new online shoppers where they are. While shopping online may be something new and uncertain for them, merchants can take the measures mentioned to retain shoppers and build their loyalty to shop online over time. If you want to take a deeper dive into this topic, you can visit our website at clear.sale. It's also linked in the description of this podcast, along with other resources to get you started. Thanks again for listening to Gateway to E-Commerce. If you like what you heard today, be sure to stay connected and subscribe or follow on all major platforms like Apple, Spotify, or iHeart. And if you have a question or would like for us to cover a topic, email us at podcast@clear.sale. We would love to hear from you. And to learn how to prevent e-commerce fraud, visit our website. We have a ton of resources dedicated to the topic that can help you on your journey to e-commerce. Until next time.
For more e-commerce insights, visit us on our website at clear.sale.